Hey. No, you're fine. No, don't. Okay.
Wrong one. Sorry. Application on Skype.
No. You just like this. Oh my God.
Sorry. We can edit this in post.
Okay, so let's share. And then you hide this.
Oh, I was supposed to pull up Skype.
And then you pull up Skype.
Okay. Yeah, sorry. I've never done a flight.
It's all good.
Alrighty. Well, good evening, everyone. My name is Peter Leyva of the UTEP College Republicans. You might have seen me in a couple of past streams. Yes, for once, I'm actually running this guest interview, not Isaac. So I have no official position, but I don't know. I might as well take some initiative. So our current
Josh Tolley.
Sorry. Our current speaker is Josh Tolley. Political commentator, Christian author. He's written several books, got a very large following. So Mr. Tolley, how you doing?
I'm doing great, Peter. How are you doing?
Really good. Stressed and exhausted, but when is that not a college student's life?
Right? You're supposed to be. So if you're stressed and exhausted, you're doing great. You're par for the course.
Pretty much. So first things first, I'd like to congratulate you on your very happy marriage and honeymoon that you just got back from.
Oh, thank you so much. That definitely helps with the stress and exhaustion, at least the honeymoon part. I don't know about the marriage part. We'll see.
Yeah, I think many people would agree. Yeah, I don't think very many people would deny. So let's get right into it.
Sure.
Alrighty. So there's the news has been just blowing up lately, and I'm sure you've seen. We've all seen that with a couple of slow weeks in news, everyone's suddenly exploding out at every opportunity to say that Trump has been some sort of tyrant because of his use of executive powers, which, let's not kid ourselves, were first expanded upon by the Obama administration, and he's just continuing on.
Right.
You know.
Right. The thing with executive powers, I think there's kind of two perspectives that we have to simultaneously look at. It's kind of like both sides of a pair of binoculars. You have to look through both, otherwise the view is distorted. The first aspect of this is that conservatives, Republicans, liberty-minded people should be watchful any time executive power is used. That's just great. It's a good thing to do. But on the other hand, like you suggested, there is precedent for where this power is coming from. And if you look at a lot of the executive powers that he's been using, the executive orders that he's been signing, a lot of them are within the framework of what is legally acceptable, where it's something that the president has the privilege or the ability to do. And that's a little bit different than what Obama did. If you remember back to Obama's first term, he was actually writing executive orders, putting those executive orders in manila envelopes, stamping those manila envelopes with top secret, putting them in a vault, and then saying that he gave himself power. And that is a completely different situation. The only difference here is that the orders that Donald Trump tends to be carrying out are ones that we actually see in our daily lives. A lot of Obama's executive orders were kind of highbrow policy sort of issues that the average Joe, unless they were political wonk or somehow affected by the order directly, paid little to no attention to. And I think that's what's causing all the attention and giving fuel to the liberal side of the conversation when it comes to what they get to make hay out of on their daily broadcasts.
Yeah, it is. It is kind of hypocritical, isn't it? You know, it's okay when their guy's in office, but suddenly when our guy's in office, oh no, this guy's a tyrant. This guy's a fascist.
it's always how it works. The people with the microphone get to declare who the people in power are. And unfortunately, we know who has the microphone. But what's really surprising is that these people still have the microphone at all. I mean, this is a media complex that has been busted, literally busted, red-handed, hands in the cookie jar, in cahoots with the Clinton campaign, working directly with the party, and I have no logical understanding as to why these people still have more than five people in the nursing home watching them every night. But again, it comes back to this idea that America is largely an emotional-driven country now and not a logical one.
Well, it's funny you should bring that up. I'll just bring this up as a brief tangent. But do you know Sargon of Akkad?
No.
Okay, so he's another YouTuber, prominent public figure, classical liberal. He brought up this point. He notices a big difference in the media between the U.S. and the U.K., you know, where he lives. He said he notices that here in America, we use the expression "I feel" very often, whereas over in the U.K., everything is "I think." You know, like, no, you do have a point. America is extremely emotionally driven, even when it claims to want to be rational, logical.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, absolutely. And for a long time, and I know this might be a touchy subject, but for a long time, that used to be the difference in the sexes before we had 28 different genders. There used to be this idea that women emotionally process logic and men logically process emotion. And for 20 years now, I've been teaching business courses to college students and CEOs alike, and that was a foundational principle of the class. But now we're getting to this point where we've so neutered the male side of the gender that everybody's becoming emotional, and that's why we have these safe spaces and all this other sort of stuff where people need cookies and puppies in order to feel good about themselves. And it's creating a country that is rotting itself away from the inside. And these protests are a great example of that. Most of these people have no clue what they're actually protesting about. Now, I'm all for protest, even if I don't agree with you. I am for the right for other people to be stupid. But at least have the wherewithal or the knowledge to know what you're protesting. And in a recent YouTube video I put up, the guy actually wanted to end the interview and admit it right there on tape. Yeah, I'm basically out here because of emotion. And that's the problem. And we encourage that sort of mindset in the public school system, in the way we parent and all that sort of stuff. So we're raising another generation coming behind even you guys that's more emotional than even what we're seeing burn the streets down in D.C. today.
Hmm. So how long would you say, you know, before these riots, you know, like what we saw at Berkeley, you know, NYU, you know, how long this ongoing violence by people like Antifa, you know, and whatnot, who I've run into personally, how long can we expect it to go on before it finally damages the left's reputation to the what I'd call the moderate majority of America?
Well, I think we're there. And I think that's why they're fighting so hard. I think the moderate majority has spoken. I think that most people are in favor of the change or the draining of the swamp or whatever it is. And if you look at the voting demographics, if you took out the state of California and the city of New York, barely anybody voted for Hillary Clinton. Mm-hmm. It's just the massive population that those two places have, and you know, a little bit of Chicago and stuff like that. But it's the massive population in liberal strongholds that make it seem as if this thing was close. Well, for goodness sakes, there are more people who live in Chicago than the entire state of Wisconsin. So when you take out these metropolitan hotspots, the rest of the country is kind of on board with common sense. So when you say, well, how long is this going to be? Well, one, I think we're there. I think the liberal mindset has lost the majority of Americans already. But two, the dangerous thing here is they still control the media. And media is extremely important because the children who are raised now with a tablet in their hand from the age of one forward are consuming media at a rate that makes people who are over the age of 20 look like their grandparents already. So we have to be careful with when is it going to hit a critical mass versus are they still being effective in their minority? And the sad part is yes, they are being effective in their minority because we continue to feed entertainment from people who we know we don't agree with.
No kidding. So should we start saying Republican values instead of Democratic values, you know, because of California, New York?
Well, I think Republican values is what we should have been saying for a long time, because I'm sure you know as well as I do that you constantly have to remind people that we do not live in a democracy. We live in a republic. And the republic, a democracy just has numbers. That's all a democracy has. Democracy is based on numbers, no values. And when you look at the two, of course we're based on Republican values. And that's a good thing. And by telling people that message, I think that message has a lot of credibility. Because even though there's this downside of the media and all that stuff that I just explained, there's still an upside where there's a human mind. And if we, as a one-on-one conversational piece, as we engage in classes and work and whatever else we do, when we engage in a conversation that gets past the emotional barrier and start talking logically, it is very hard to argue with conservative values, which is why in mass, they always dispute it. In mass, when it's numbers, they're going to have riots with vaginas on their heads. They're going to light things on fire. But when it comes one-on-one, there's no rebuttal because you can't rebut value. You can only rebut emotion based on numbers.
Mm-hmm. Founders had an expression for that called tyranny of the majority.
Exactly.
So let's talk about what people are always calling the Muslim ban and what it is exactly.
Yeah, this whole idea of this Muslim ban is just absolutely ridiculous. First, we have to realize that nobody's banning Muslims. Second, we have to realize that Muslim is not a religion, or not a race, rather. Third, we have to realize that even if it was somehow a Muslim ban, that we're not banning anybody based on their religion. We're banning people based on their country of origin. Now, should that list be expanded past the seven countries that it currently has on it? Yeah, absolutely, most definitely. But we have to realize that this idea that we're banning people is ridiculous. The only thing that he's proposed is a 90 to 120 day pause on immigration because of what the FBI under Obama admitted, which is why Obama came up with this plan in 2015. The FBI said there is absolutely no way to vet these people. Interestingly enough, Germany, France, Norway, Austria, Spain, Italy, Greece, England now agree with that, as they're dealing with the reality of the problem of not being able to vet these people. Even if you look at organizations that lean progressive, the WHO and the UN, they admit that most of these Syrian refugees are not really Syrian. Most of them are not women and children. And most of them, the vast majority of them, agree with the expansion of Sharia law. Now, Sharia law in and of itself is enough to be considered a terrorist act. So when you have these progressives talking about, well, there's not many people who've been murdered by refugees, you have to realize that's not the point. Who cares? It's absolutely irrelevant. When people take a pledge in the armed services, military, political office, or whatever, they take a pledge to defend the Constitution against all enemies, foreign and domestic. It is really easy to figure out what a foreign enemy is. If Russia parked a spy ship 30 miles off the coast of they did. That's easy to identify. But a domestic enemy to the Constitution, what is that? When they take that pledge, they're not pledging to defend the parchment. The parchment is encased in glass, in a safe. You're never going to get to it. That's not what you're protecting. You're protecting what you referenced earlier, Peter, which is Republican values. So when people say, I take an oath to defend the Constitution against enemies, foreign and domestic, that translates into to defend the Republican values which are on the Constitution against all enemies, foreign and domestic. Well, that means a domestic enemy is anybody who wants to usurp or dismantle those Republican values. Sharia law is exactly that. It runs contrary to the Republican values. Therefore, it is a terrorist act. Therefore, anybody who even wants to advance Sharia is considered, according to the Constitution, a terrorist and a domestic enemy. So this idea that somehow they have to shoot up 40 people at a mall before it's considered bad is just, again, them emotionally trying to gain ground where logically they have none.
Oh, exactly. It's absolutely terrible, the mental gymnastics that they must have to go through. And on the note, still about these countries, what is the vetting process for immigration supposed to be? You know, and what is it in these countries that that this immigration moratorium, which more accurately describes it, you know, what is it for these countries?
Well, that's where this gets tricky, and that's why the moratorium, the pause, whatever you want to call it, makes a lot of sense. So, for example, in countries like Syria, which is why so many refugees are Syrian, this whole idea to get an identity in Syria is fairly easy. In Iraq, it's the same thing. After the surge in Iraq, after we pulled out of that surge and we left all that equipment behind, we didn't just leave behind military equipment. We left behind, for some stupid reason, equipment made that creates identification. So passports, ID cards, all that sort of stuff. Well, who do you think has control of this?
ISIS.
So basically what we're doing is we're letting the terrorists act like 18-year-old college freshmen who get to make a fake ID from the state of Nevada. I remember when I was college age, the license that you wanted was a Nevada license because they were the easiest to fake. So lo and behold, I had 27 friends all from the state of Nevada. Mm-hmm. Well, the same is true with a Syrian or an Iraqi identification. For about $50, call yourself anything. And if you remember the latest French attack, that guy had 5 different identities, all of them legit, vetted, and legal. So when you get to this point where you say, hey, wait a second, we know at least a certain percentage of these people want to do harm, whether physical or to the Constitution, those Republican values, we need to take a step back and say, where are they getting these identifications? How is this process actually working? We know the process for getting the identification doesn't work. But then what happens? Well, then they submit it. And under Obama, the Obama administration said that they did 600 interviews a day to vet these refugees. For goodness sakes, McDonald's can't interview 600 people and get it right to get the people in the offices and positions they need. How are we supposed to think that 600 interviews were conducted and we figured out everything we needed to know about these people? Why is it harder to get into any college in the United States than it is to get into the United States? And that's part of the problem. So the ID can be faulty, the process is faulty, and then here's the other part. They can lie. We don't put them under a lie detector test. As a matter of fact, I had a guest on my show today that talked about that very issue, how the Obama administration didn't want to give refugees lie detector tests because they thought it was an invasion of their privacy. So they could literally lie. They could say, hey, my name is Bob, I love the United States, I vote Republican, I love the Yankees, whatever. They get here and then they blow up a bunch of people. Well, what happened? He lied. And I don't know if it's American stupidity. I don't know if it's just American naivete because we grew up with, I don't know, Archie Bunker and Leave It to Beaver or whatever it is. But we have this resistance to think that anybody else would actually lie to us. And that, in and of itself, is part of the problem that we're facing from a security measure. And then beyond that, you have to look at who are the puppets behind this thing. You have the Muslim Brotherhood, which the past 5 administrations actually have been in bed with, both sides, Republicans and Democrats. And you have them who are behind a lot of these issuing organizations that issue the identification. Well, this organization has been identified as a terrorist organization, yet they operate on pretty much every campus in the United States, and they're the ones that set policy on how Muslims are treated inside the intelligence community, which leads you to the conclusion, which is very logical, that this entire system is messed up. And if we're going to try to protect ourselves, we have to push pause and figure this thing out.
Yeah, it's really crazy too, especially again with the sort of the mental gymnastics like leftists are in the middle of. You know, it's a combination of altruism and virtue signaling. You know, it's altruism for the sincere ones, and then for the not so sure ones, just virtue signaling. And sort of on that note, is there any way that we can really clean up both the major parties, since both of them have had big government attitudes, corruption, and have been in bed with some of our worst of enemies? Is there any hope to clean up the two big political parties?
That's a really good question. And, you know, it kind of comes in waves. During the Ron Paul era, the 2 times he ran, a lot of people thought, okay, well, we're going to get people in position in local Republican offices, and that's going to be the change in the tide that we need. But then the Republican Rules Committee and changed the rules to make it harder to be a grassroots activist. And then they were caught on video kind of rigging the vote. And that, of course, set off a firestorm. They didn't see Maine. That set off a firestorm. So people thought, okay, well, that didn't work. And because of people like Ryan Priebus, who's actually from the same city I'm from, Madison, Wisconsin, there was a lot of establishment that was squashing the voice of the youth, the voice of the more constitutionally minded people. Well, the same was kind of happening on the Democrat side. Even though I totally despise where they were going, the Bernie Sanders kind of movement was the Ron Paul version. Now, he's not a Ron Paul, that's a ridiculous comparison, but in terms of a movement, they were kind of similar. It was a bunch of people saying, hey, wait a second, Debbie Wasserman Schultz is in bed with the Clinton administration, and this whole thing is just a ruse, they're lying to us, so at least let's try to go in a different direction. If you look at Bernie's background, he's just as deep into the cesspool of snakes as Hillary was, but that's a different show. The reality is that as it stands right now, the closest thing we had was the Trump administration. The Trump administration, the whole drain the swamp, the whole this is your America, is, I would think, the last effort, at least for a generation, to reclaim one of the two parties. If the Trump administration somehow fails or destroys itself from within or abuses the voting base that kind of changed the Republican Party, then it's going to be a very long time before either party gets credibility, which would lead to the rise, or the continued rise rather, of an alternative system of multiple parties like Italy, or at least a fair system where you don't have to go through this whole process of top two voting systems that most states have in order to get on the ballot. So it depends. Depends how this Trump thing works out, and people are already looking at it saying, hey, you know, it's time to break apart these parties.
No kidding. So the big question, Michael Flynn.
Yes, sir.
Was his resignation a mistake?
Oh, you know, this is a complicated issue. So we have Flynn doing something that probably wasn't so good. Mm-hmm. We have Flynn doing something that optically was just terrible. Any public relation person out there would say, well, this sucks. Where you already have the left banging the drums, talking about how Russia's involved in the election and all that sort of stuff before it even happens. And then you have all this pressure come down from the inside. And we mentioned Ryan's Priebus a little bit earlier, and it's kind of been overlooked by the Republican side how that actually plays into this too. Ryan's is facing the possible chopping block because of this whole thing. And I don't know. Part of me thinks that, you know what, you have a brand new administration, you are under attack 24/7, anything that is sticking out needs to kind of be tucked in or chopped off. And as rude and as crude as that might be, there's a little bit of truth to that. I mean, you know they're gunning for anything at this point that sticks out. The other side says, wait a second, this was a complete inside job. This is exactly what they were trying to fight against in the first place. This intelligence community-driven, media-fueled expose of how they still hold control. And that's really what this is. This is not about Flynn. And I think that's an important message people need to realize. This was a warning shot across the bow. Flynn was just a warning. And what that warning is saying is, hey, wait a second. The intelligence community, the establishment that built this city, and the media that empowers us, we're not just going to roll over. This whole idea that you won an election and thought you could come in and drain the swamp and we'd just say, okay, well, I guess you won, we're going to pack our bags, that's not going to happen. And this is really, to be honest, kind of a coup. This is people inside the government, inside the intelligence committee breaking the law, disclosing information, and that's not even touching how they got the transcripts, which they're trying to backpedal and explain as somehow, well, we were spying on the Russians and they just happened to be talking to Flynn. No, that's not true. That doesn't fly either. So even without the FBI version of this, this is still a messy legal thing. So at the end of the day, I don't think this is going to be too damaging to the administration, to be honest. I think this thing is still so new. We're still within the first 100 days. Flynn didn't have that many policies that he was in the middle of carrying out that now go unintended. So if it had to happen, the timing was actually great for Flynn and it was great for Trump. Should it have happened? No, not really. And if we really wanted to dig deep, I think there's even tape of Hillary admitting to something similar around the same issue when Trump went to Mexico, and he was talking about how he had such a great, wonderful relationship with the Mexican president and all that sort of stuff. I believe, if memory serves me correctly, she said that people on her team were also having great conversations because look at us, this is how good I am too. But if you look at who was on her team, they were not yet sworn in officials either, which would have violated the same Logan Act that Flynn was guilty of. But again, the FBI doesn't seem to want to go after the Clintons, so the world may never know.
Yeah, it's scary. Like, I've heard some people refer to this this sort of residual malice in D.C. as like almost like an Obama shadow government. You know, it's pretty scary stuff.
Yeah, I mean, to be honest, all these, it's kind of like what Sean Hannity and Judge Napolitano said on the Hannity program a couple years ago. All these people who were sounding like kooks talking about conspiracy theories were all proven right. And that's really what we're looking at. Who run the intelligence community, the CIA, the NSA, the DIA, all these alphabet soup agencies, who are not going out without a fight. And even when it was President-elect Trump, there was already contention. Because remember, he was talking about how, you know what, I don't think I should be taking these daily security briefings. They're really not telling me anything different every day. Just tell me new information as we go. Well, even at that point, the intelligence community was pushing back against him because they felt like he was raining on their parade, peeing in their Cheerios. And they knew they had an ally with the Obama administration and everybody who was appointed by Obama because of the loyalty that they bonded over when it came to the whole Benghazi issue. So, yeah, this is like a novel brought to life.
Oh, no kidding. You know, I mean, take Alex Jones, for instance. You know, everyone always dismissed him as the crazy conspiracy nut, and then come the election season, he's right about almost everything. You know, we never thought we'd live to see James Bond type villains, you know, like George Soros, but lo and behold, we have people like George Soros who don't even bother trying to hide their attempts at infiltration and influence, and they somehow managed to get away scot-clean. It's what a time to be alive.
Oh, it is. It's absolutely crazy. If somehow we survive this era while talking about it, it's going to be something to tell our children about, because at this point, I'm half expecting Soros to have a mini-me and a hairless cat.
Oh, geez.
Because, I mean, it's true, and this whole idea, and you bring up Alex Jones, it's interesting. I'm just going to plug myself for a minute. Every day I host a talk show Monday through Friday, 9 to 11, on the GCN network, and Alex and I actually share the same soundboard. But, yes, absolutely true. This whole idea that there is this conspiracy, and we're seeing it play out, even with what Russia's doing, parking the spy ship off the coast of Delaware and going down the coast. That's not accidental. That's totally on purpose. They know what they're doing. And Putin, who totally outsmarted Obama from day one, is trying to gain the upper hand still, even though he's looking friendly and, hey, we want to work together to defeat ISIS. Don't for one second think that Bond villain is going quietly into the night either. He has globalist ambitions, just his version instead of Obama's. And he's going to see what sort of runaround he can work here. And so far, everybody's paying attention to Flynn.
Yeah, he's trying to see what little bit he can get now that there's a new sheriff in town.
Yeah, exactly. And you always test those boundaries.
Yeah, test the water. You know, just how far can I get with this?
Yep.
So moving on with the Trump administration, what's all this controversy, you know, behind Education Secretary DeVos? You know, isn't education reform something we've really needed since the Carter administration? You know, like, are these old battles? You know, my parents grew up without a federal Department of Education. You know, what's all the fuss? What's with the stirring pot?
Well, there's a couple things, and to be honest, there's a couple things from both sides. From the Republican side, there are some whispers that they're not too happy with how she handles the Islamic issue. And that's kind of like the tiny part of the boss argument. Mm-hmm. On the other side, though, there's a larger issue, and that's the teachers' union and everything that comes along with it. As well, the family that she's a part of, the DeVos family, owns Amway. So there's a whole, you know, entrepreneurship and Christian attacking sort of element too, as the DeVos family has given hundreds of millions to conservative and Christian causes. So they already came into this not liking this woman's family. Now, as far as the teachers' unions are concerned, yeah, we need to get rid of the Department of Education. The Constitution clearly points out that the states are responsible for education, not the federal government. And this is at least a move towards seeing some of that control put back in these states' hands, and more importantly, into the hands of the parents. Well, the largest union that we have, or the second largest union we have, is the teachers' union. They have a lot of pull. Not only do they have a lot of pull when it comes to membership and money, they have a lot of pull when it comes to emotion. And remember, that's the most important part here. The miners, the coal miners, not a lot of pull emotionally. People don't think of coal miners and want to go buy a Hallmark car. The auto workers, to be honest. The auto workers, a lot of them were supporting Trump. That didn't get a lot of left liberal play because, again, you don't think of auto workers and want to buy a bouquet of flowers. Teachers are a different story. Teachers are something that the media knows that if they anchor this story to them, they can tear apart another one of those things that are sticking out, kind of like Flynn. The teachers have been worshipped in this country. I remember growing up, even the local television stations had Teacher of the Week awards, as if somehow this warranted some sort of homage or praise. And I'm not saying anything wrong with teachers. That's not what I'm saying. But we have the tendency in this country to hold teachers up on this sort of almost deity platform. And along with that, I have had public school teachers tell me directly that parents should not have as much control over a child's life as a teacher does. Because teachers are specially trained to raise children, where all parents did was have sex. So obviously the teachers need to have more control and power. Well, if you mix that sort of element with the media element, which is totally based on emotion, nobody goes and sees the John Wick movie based on logic. It's all emotion on both sides. Entertainment and media is all emotion. So when you engage in an emotional platform and then you partner that with an emotional profession where we think about teachers and, you know, the nice little grandma lady that you bought the apple for in fourth grade, it allows them to have a weapon that nobody dares attack back. Wait. See, if they were going after coal workers, the coal workers and the truck drivers and the conservatives could attack back. But nobody, or at least they're hoping nobody, has the guts to attack the lovely, wonderful teachers. So that gives them the ability to go after DeVos, because DeVos, if she's successful, is going to put control of that social message into the parents' hands. And this is why, I know this is a little tangential, but it's totally relevant. This is why pre-K was such a huge issue when it came out. The reason they developed pre-K was not because of some sort of grandiose, benevolent idea. It was because they found studies that specifically showed the more time of influence you have with a child between 3 and 5, the more you set their personality and their disposition for the rest of their life. That's why public schools push so hard for pre-K. Well, if this comes to pass, that DeVos has the reforms that she's wishing for, then it's going to get rid of a lot of that influence. This is also why in the state of California, the Obama administration filed a suit in the Sixth Circuit Court fighting against homeschooling, because there's a rise of that too. Mm-hmm. And anything that eliminates or reduces the power for that criminal element like Soros, Obama, Clinton, whatever, to influence the social makeup of children, they're going to attack. It's one thing to attack old people who aren't going to vote in 4 years. But when you start taking away the ability for the left to influence children, they're going to fight that tooth and nail. Because if you look at the voting demographics of the 25 and unders, one every state. Every single state was blue. And if you look at what the number one candidate for 20 and under, 25 and unders were, even on the Democrat side, it was Bernie Sanders. Mm-hmm. And it's interesting to point out that Bernie Sanders is a candidate of the parents creation, of schools creation. We love to think that Bernie was this anomaly, Democrat socialist, but because he looks like Mr. Magoo, everybody fell in love. That's not what it is. What it is if you rewind the clock 25 years ago, we had parents and teachers telling everybody in school, well, little Billy, you have the fire truck, Sally doesn't, so you have to share. Well, Tommy, you have 4 Lincoln Logs, and Bob doesn't have any, you need to share. So what is the candidate that these people voted for 20 to 25 years later? The candidate that said, you have too much, you need to share. And that illustrates the power of the teaching system. Bernie Sanders was the direct result of kindergarten classes. And somebody needs to do a larger story on that because the impact is huge, which is exactly why they are fighting so hard to retain control of those kindergarten classes.
Wow, I need to research into that. That's a very fascinating topic, but holy cow, you're right. I mean, pre-K and kindergarten does teach kids to be a bunch of little entitled socialists.
Oh, yeah. Everybody who's 7 and under in school is a socialist.
Well, you know, what was troublesome, a little personal anecdote, really troublesome. My little brother, so me and my sister, you know, being raised in good little Christian children as we were. So my littlest brother, who's almost exactly 10 years younger than me, you know, me and my sister trying to, you know, explain some wisdom to him. We talked about like communism, you know, how it's not fair, and it could not process in his little kid brain. He was so fixated on the idea of people coming out completely equally at the finish line. And I'm like, holy cow, where did this come from? I literally explained this in the most logical sense I could. Hey, if you want it, you got to work for it. And you know what? The world doesn't evenly distribute stuff. So why should, you know, it is terrifying. I need to research more on this, but holy cow.
Well, and you know, that just goes to show why we are not having a logical conversation in this country right now. Because logic is completely irrelevant. They don't want logic. They want their emotions justified. They want their emotions, I don't know, soon.
Validated.
Until that happens, there's going to be a resistance because they feel emotionally hurt. Mm-hmm.
You know, and kind of and really closely related to that, is, you know, based on all we're talking about here, is this not just a total coincidence that teachers are put on what you call, you know, this pedestal, that the feds want to push more and more control, you know, of young minds to academic education? You know, is this all coincidence, or is this truly nefarious, you know, cultural Marxism type stuff?
Oh, it's truly nefarious. It's truly nefarious. 20 years ago, you could say, oh, well, anybody who thinks about that is just some sort of, you know, weird conspiracy theorist. But I was in Wisconsin. I live in St. Louis now, but I was living in Wisconsin during the whole Scott Walker recall thing. And I remember standing next to Andrew Breitbart before he died. Ooh. And we're standing there on the Capitol steps in Madison, Wisconsin, and we are watching these teachers bringing their students to this protest. They were getting sick notes, getting them out of class, you know, field trip, depending on what school, what teacher was doing. But they were bringing the teachers, or they were bringing the students, rather, to this protest because they knew how important it is to expose these children's minds. And we were listening to them say things like, see those men up there? Those men, meaning me and Breitbart and whoever else was talking, those men want fill in the blank. Miss Teacher Phillips, to suffer. They don't think Miss Phillips should get money. They want to take away. Well, these kids are like, oh, how dare you? We hate the man with the red beard. You know, and it was crazy because they knew what they were doing. So 20 years ago, yeah, you would have been called a conspiracy theorist. But today, you see the exact opposite. I have a younger brother, too. He was one of those, you know, oops, got pregnant, sort of brothers. And when he was in school just a few years ago, the math teacher had a poster talking about how there are too many guns. Well, wait a second. How does this have anything to do with math? Unless we're talking about how many rounds fit in Josh's magazine, this has nothing to do with math. It is a social message. So no, it's totally on purpose. They know exactly what they're doing. And when you look at places like Texas, where you happen to be, there's a group called Act for America that launched a Texas textbook program, and they found 1,500 errors in Texas textbooks. You telling me that that's on accident? No, that's not an accident. That's on purpose. They know exactly what they're doing.
Oh, yeah, it's crazy. Like, sort of an additional bit of youth perspective on just how much the government is trying to infiltrate on every little aspect of our personal lives. Like, have you seen the questionnaires at doctor's offices now? Oh, does your house own guns? Oh, or do your parents fight a lot? Oh, do you feel safe, you know, with this parent, with that parent? You know, oh, you know, your siblings, how do you get along with them? Oh, you know, are you people of faith? Oh, are you patriotic? And, like, I'm like, where did these questions come from?
Oh, yeah. Peter, I'm going to take it one step further. I had an attorney on my show a year and a half ago who called in and said, you know, Josh, there's something that you need to be aware of. In the VA system, what they are doing to veterans is they're giving them the option to either keep their Second Amendment rights or keep their VA services.
Yes.
And they justified it by saying that if anybody else is in control of your medical account, say a wife or a loved one, then you are voluntarily admitting that you are not of sound mind. And because of that, we're not taking away your rights. We're giving you the choice. So they legally got through that, and they were taking away guns from veterans. And it turned out to be an absolutely true story. The conservative media kind of ran with it for a while. But he said, Josh, I'm going to warn you, it's coming to civilians next. Well, about a year ago, not even, they were talking about that same thing coming through Medicare and Medicaid. And this idea of, well, you know, you're not competent, and because of what you have at home, you're a danger to yourself, and we're not taking away your rights. It's your choice. You can either have Medicare, Medicaid, or you can give us your guns.
Wow. I remember the former story, by the way. You know, I remember reading that stuff, you know, how the VA was, you know, doing this nefarious gun grab, but holy cow, I didn't even realize that this was beginning to bleed over into civilian stuff. I mean, this is scary.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, I'm glad I live in Texas. I'm glad I live in a state to have somebody, to have a governor like Greg Abbott, who's always giving the middle finger to the feds. But holy cow, I can't imagine not living in Texas now in light of this, you know? It's terrifying. Simply terrifying. So I guess to sort of move topics, have you noticed a sudden resurgence or sort of a reshoring, a return of secular people to the right wing? And,
yeah,
and what are
yeah,
your thoughts on
it? Yeah, I think so. I think that, well, I think that's fueled by a couple different things. I think that's fueled by a lot of people leaving faith. We are losing 3 million people a year out of churches and out of faith. So I think the resurgence is because of a couple things. One, you now have former believers who are still not stupid enough to become progressives. So they're coming back to the Republican Party. But I think on the other side of that, you have a lot of people who are realizing how just emotionally nuts the progressives are. For a long time, under the first Clinton administration and under Obama, they could kind of hide it. I mean, sure, you had talk show hosts like G. Gordon Liddy and, you know, Michael Savage exposing it to people who were looking for it. But for the most part, they kind of hid it. Well, now, like you said before, they're not even hiding it. These people have gone straight crazy. And I think a lot of people are responding to that who still have a logical brain. And they're saying, hey, wait a second. This is nuts. I need to go the other direction. There's only two options, really, unless you want to go with Gary Johnson or Jill Stein. So let's go back to the Republican Party. And I think you've seen the same thing when it comes to the demographics that Trump was supposed to lose. I mean, he won the most Hispanic city in the country. He also did better with Hispanics and blacks than he was supposed to, twice as well as the previous Republican candidate. And I think a lot of that is because a lot of them are saying, hey, wait a second, with the exception of immigration, what else do I agree with progressives on? If you look at Latino culture, regardless of if it's Mexico, Guatemala, wherever, take out immigration. If you take that out, they are very pro-business, very entrepreneur, very pro-life, very religious, very pretty much Republican platform.
You know, I can actually testify to this. This is something I actually talked about with our previous guest, that I guarantee you, if it was not for the immigration issue, all Hispanics would be hardcore Republicans. Cubans are pretty much all Republican because they know, they've seen firsthand communism, socialism does not work. South America is fairly mixed, but Haitians despise the left, especially after the whole Clinton fiasco. But for some weird reason, and again, living here on the border with Mexico, Mexico's right over there, you know, I can literally point to it right over there. Mexican Hispanics don't seem to learn. The left has hooked them on this notion that Republicans are all a bunch of evil, racist, white people who want to deport them, who don't like racial diversity. And then little by little, they sort of drip feed social justice into them so that Mexicans have a very weird mix of really progressive and really conservative values, but they'll vote almost solidly Democrat, like Mexican Hispanic. You know, you're completely right. If it was not for the immigration issue, I guarantee you most of us would be straight up Republican, no questions asked.
Oh yeah. Yeah, absolutely. But again, they play on emotion, mm-hmm. not logic. They play on emotion. The whole idea of La Raza, emotion.
La Raza.
The idea of Mexican, it slipped my mind, something to do with a Pride Day or something. Again, it's emotion. And yes, we should have pride, and yes, we should have emotions. I'm not trying to say these things are bad. What I'm saying is that they are being played upon. They're being manipulated by the left. I was in a cab with a lady. Actually, I was in an Uber, because the lady was an entrepreneur. And I was in an Uber, and the driver was from Venezuela. And again, just like the Cubans, they saw firsthand what happened when you go crazy left socialist. So she's diehard conservative. And the Mexicans just have not had that opportunity, because both sides of that border are playing on the emotions. You have the Mexican government doing the same thing, you know, saying, you know, oh, those evil Americans, they don't want you to come in and vote for the ones that want you. And, you know, here's a voting guide. Well, holy cow. When we complain about Russia possibly influencing elections, why don't we talk about Mexico doing it for the past 40 years? They try to influence every election we have with their own citizens who happen to be living here.
Mm-hmm. We have illegals registered to vote. We have dead grandparents registered to vote. We have people from the distant past registered to vote. We have Mickey Mouse tends to vote, especially in Florida. I am not kidding. Especially in Florida, you'll find a lot of ballots labeled Mickey Mouse. But no, it's true. You know, if we're gonna gripe about something as completely unsubstantiated as Russia, yeah, why aren't we going after Mexico on this? It's crazy. It's amazing. Again, the mental gymnastics the left will go through to exonerate these people.
That's exactly it. Because they really, at the end of the day, they don't have to exonerate them. They just have to have you emotionally sympathize with them. And we see this in movies. I mean, a great case, a little out there, but a great case for that is even look at how we've turned bad guys into good guys. Vampires and wolves are now the focus of love stories. You know, we have movies about the hitman who needs to fall in love and have a great life too. And when he's arrested, we cry for him. No, he should be shot. But we've really gone down this crazy emotional road where we have created evil good and good evil. And if you're a Bible believer, you're thinking to yourself, wait a second, didn't I read that someplace?
Isaiah.
Yeah, you did.
Oh yeah, Isaiah, that exact verse. You know, woe to those who call evil good and good evil. You know, we have really hit that. We broke that barrier a long time ago, but it's never, you can never not be astounded at just when you think we've hit rock bottom, we dig even deeper. You know.
Yeah.
And speaking of the Women's March on March 8th, the idea of not showing up for work on some sort of mass strike. What do these women, these feminist women, expect to accomplish?
Emotional solidarity. That's really all they're after. There is no real expectation of fixing any of the fake problems that they think they have, because they're largely fake problems. The only thing they're after is emotional solidarity. Just like when governors were going after public unions and we heard that's disgusting, union busting, or solidarity, brother, that's exactly what we're going after here. This is a woman's union. That's all it is. And the reality is that they're doing a very large disservice to women. And a lot of women, thankfully, a lot of women are seeing through this. I am so encouraged by the number of conservative women who are saying, yeah, you are bat crap crazy. And we need to get back to this place where we realize that women and men are different and it's good and it's okay. And all these stats you're coming up with about, hey, we make less is absolutely wrong. I mean, for goodness sakes, if women actually made, I'm an entrepreneur. I've been an entrepreneur for 20 years. If women actually made less for doing the same work, I would hire all women by the end of this sentence.
Exactly. Exactly. If you could legally pay a woman less than a man, what intelligent employer wouldn't fire every single one of his male employees and hire only women? These people suggest that our misogyny, our hatred of women is just so much more than realizing we could pay women less if that was such a thing. You know, it's just intellectually inconsistent. It's absurd. And it's illegal since 1963, the Equal Pay Act. You know, these people don't realize that just because you give people equal opportunities, people aren't going to take these equal opportunities equally. You know, go look at the jobs women actually take. Go look at the jobs men take. Look how many hours men work versus how many hours women work. You know, Dr. Christina Hoff Sommers, you know, she writes a lot about this. It's just absurd, all these many emotionally driven but factually inconsistent feminist notions that millions upon millions of women will go out and march as if they're taking part in some huge civil rights movement, and yet what are they really accomplishing? Other than
absolutely nothing. The number one female, or the number one entertainer, period. The number one entertainer last year was a female who made over $128 million in 1 year. Her name is Taylor Swift. Nobody is complaining about how, I don't know, Gwen Stefani didn't make as much as Taylor, or Blake Shelton didn't make as much as Gwen. I mean, it's insane. It's absolutely stupid. But it also robs women of being women. And this is a very serious point. I talk to a lot of college-age people, and a lot of the women are saying, man, I just want to be a woman. Some of us want to have families. Some of us want to have husbands. Some of us want to stay home, for goodness sakes. And a lot of us choose careers based on what we are emotionally tied to. A man will choose a career based on logic. He will say, okay, wait a second. This is what I'm good at. This is how much money I need to make, and I want to retire by 50. Go. A woman, and great attribute, by the way, a woman says, I have a heart for children. I want to be a teacher. I have a heart for healing. I want to be a nurse. Well, that's awesome, but those careers make less. Now, some women are like, you know what? No, I want to be a CEO, and I want to run Yahoo, and I want to make money. Okay, go for it. Nobody's making you less money. So it's just ridiculous, and it nauseates me, but praise God there are some still women out there who want to be women. Now it's up to the men who want to be men, because that's really where the attack is. Men are the dunce in every commercial and sitcom. Fathers are the butt of every joke, and I'm kind of mad that I have to pay 100% more when I go out to get a drink than women do. Where's the pay gap there? Why do women get to drink for free when I have to pay?
Yeah, it's crazy, you know, and everything you've brought up, and this is something I alluded to earlier. I alluded to cultural Marxism because I started hearing it being used as an expression more and more as the election came closer and closer. But does this radicalized sect of feminism, as well as these other radical anti-patriotic, anti-marriage factors and anti-everything, you know, are these people out to destroy the Judeo-Christian concept of marriage and nuclear family? Like, is that like their ultimate end goal?
They are out to destroy masculinity. That's the goal, wherever it happens to be. So they're going to attack it in Christianity. They're going to attack it in atheism. They're going to attack it in secular humanism. It doesn't matter where they want to attack it. They're going to attack it because masculinity is what created countries. And it's not to take away from anything women contribute. Hallelujah. Praise God. You're awesome. And without women, this whole country would already be dead. But with that being said, it's the men who have stood up and said enough is enough. Look at just this seriously. Look at the difference in riots. When you're on like Twitter and stuff and you see like, holy cow, 400,000 people are marching in Ukraine or in Egypt or France or Germany. And then we get excited because 600 people show up to a tea party. Why is that? It's because men in other countries are still men. A man in France is a man. A man in Mexico is a man. We might not agree with how they do it or whatever, but it's still true. Here, we are taught not to be. And we make fun of it. Even our comedians. I mean, think of every comedian or every serious male actor. At some point, they dress him up like a woman. Whether it's Robert De Niro, John Travolta, Martin Lawrence, it doesn't matter. Pick anybody. And they'll dress him up as a woman at some point in their career. Arnold Schwarzenegger, it don't matter. And at the same time, they always make the men the butt of the jokes. Always. Okay. So when we look at what they're after, that's what they're after.
No kidding. And yet they dare not speak against women in anything more than like an amiable joke. I mean, no, you're very right that jokes about men are so much more antagonistic than jokes about women. Jokes about women tend to be over tiny little things, and generally you're not going to see as many of those on Saturday Night Live skits. But holy cow, are men ever demonized for being masculine? You know, we're the ones made out to be the pig-headed, short-sighted, sex-obsessed, control-obsessed, or even if none of those things, just absent-minded buffoons.
Yeah.
But if anyone were to dare make any joke remotely similar in caliber about women, it would be end of the world.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I saw a car commercial recently, or maybe it was insurance. It had something to do with cars. And how the dad – oh, I remember what it was. It was the one where Dennis – what's his face's voice comes out of other people's mouth for all state. Says that thing about, you know, you still think women voters are whatever. If that was a reverse commercial, there would be bras burning everywhere. But no. That's a women empowerment commercial. If it was a man who said, you really think I can't drive as well as a woman, everybody'd be upset. But because it's making the man look like an idiot, everybody loves it. Let's buy some Allstate. You're in good hands.
Mm-hmm. It's crazy. So can I ask one final question as one Christian to another?
Yeah.
So I've been noticing this. I've actually come to follow a few atheist and otherwise skeptic YouTube channels who are very much against the social justice warrior nonsense. And I have to admit, there's something I'm very terrified about, and I kind of want your insight on. When the dust settles, you know, when social justice is finally destroyed once and for all, do you think that the right will experience a mass exodus? Or do you think that because conservatism has evolved, become more, as people like Milo Yiannopoulos, Alan Bakari would say, more culturally libertarian, do you think we can retain the atheist and the skeptic voter bloc? Because they make comparisons all the time. I'm not going to lie. The religious right of the 70s to the 90s was pretty embarrassing. Let's not kid ourselves. You know, calling board games like Dungeons and Dragons satanic and gateway drugs to Satan, saying that violent video games could turn you into a school shooter. You know, like all these ridiculous moral busybody notions that they love to broad stroke paint us with. They make constant comparison between them and feminists, between them and Black Lives Matter. You know, when the dust finally settles and social justice is just vanquished once and for all, we're all sort of on a moderate playing field again, do you think we can retain the skeptic voter bloc? Or are we gonna have to go back to the vitriolic theist versus atheist debates all over again?
Well, One, that's a really good question. Two, I think it depends a lot upon if we can get rid of the social justice warrior thing. I think that is a much larger fight than atheist versus theist. I think the social justice warrior thing is really a fight for the heart and soul of America. That's where the action is. That's where the line is drawn. If we win, if for some reason we get rid of all these over-emotional wusses, and it comes back to conservative versus liberal, I think at that point it's going to have a lot to do with Christianity. And it's interesting. Right now we're seeing a lot of people leave faith. We're seeing a lot of churches shut down, 7,000 churches a year, for example, shut down in the United States. A lot of people leave in faith. But the people who remain are not the version of social justice warriors. They are, like, it's kind of odd. I was actually speaking at a church 2 weeks ago talking about this. The people who are remaining in churches are the ones who know the churches. When you look back at, like, the Farwells and all that sort of stuff, and I'm not saying he didn't know the Bible, but when you look at that era, the Bible literacy rate was terrible. Most atheists knew the Bible more than believers. But today that's shifting. Today the people who are remaining are the ones who actually want to read it, understand it, and practice it. And I think if Christianity can hold on to that, then I think the conservative political side is going to be all right. Because there's a reality there that is not so much about I'm emotionally afraid, like the whole Dungeons and Dragons thing you talked about. And it turns back into what it started as. These are the principles. We get them from the Bible. Do you want liberty? Yes. Great. Follow me. And the revolution was led by the blue or the black robe brigades. So I think right now it all depends on what happens to Christianity more so than what happens with, you know, Ryan's Priebus or whatever the Republican platform is next, you know, midterms or whatever.
Yeah, because that was my point, is that for the time being, fighting social justice unites us. But no, you are right. The church has very much evolved. The church has gotten a lot better at defending the faith, better at apologetics, better at accepting certain scientific principles and being able to use science in our debates. I mean, a lot of our younger apologists, or even some of our older ones, like, say, Ravi Zacharias, you know, they can hold their own.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I actually know Ravi. We were at a pastor's conference together. Not that I'm a pastor, but we were both there at it was in Orlando a year ago. And you're absolutely right. And we were kind of talking about this idea that even the atheists, and I think this is going to play a factor into it too. You asked a really good question, Peter.
Thank you.
I think this is going to play a factor into it too. We have atheists who are getting to the point where they can't ignore intelligent design anymore either. Mm-hmm. So this whole conversation about, you know, well, were dinosaurs here when Fred Flintstone was, you know, all that sort of stuff that we saw with the Hovens and all that sort of thing in the 70s through the 90s, all that's kind of gone away. But if you really look at headlines lately, there were two computer scientists who run the math on a mathematical equation, both of them from Europe, but peer-reviewed science, that mathematically proves that there is a God. There was a study done, I believe, in California. Again, peer-reviewed study, the mind exists outside of your brain. Even people like Richard Dawkins are now yielding to the point of, yes, there is a design. He personally believes it's alien seed planting or some weird thing. But, Neil deGrasse Tyson and Krauss or Laus or whatever his name from Arizona, they're all getting to this point where they're saying, okay, it's a hologram, it's a computer model, whatever, because they're getting to this point where they can no longer ignore the design. So we're even seeing that kind of bridge this gap. And I've had conversations with atheists and believers alike who are both trying to wrestle with this idea where, in reality, atheism kind of had their golden age between about 1650 and 1850. where there was just enough science to make the supernatural story sound weird, but not enough to prove it wrong. But today, we're having science come along and prove things in the quantum physics world that would make these atheist scientists seem like pastors only 20 years ago.
Oh, it is absolutely crazy, you know, the way the paradigm shifts between the believers and the skeptics. And I am very interested to see where it goes. And I'm glad that as a whole, the church is not fighting science, but using science in debates, you know, and that will dictate the course of just what sort of place faith will play in American society, you know, in a post-SJW future. So,
yeah, which I hope we have.
I really do, too. I could use a third great awakening. So, so do you have any, closing remarks for our viewers?
Yeah, just keep on keeping on logically. You know, the slogan I run by is logic, reason, and strategy. You have to think logically. Logic form foundation has to come before you get emotionally invested. Keep that at the forefront of your mind when looking at any issue. In addition to that, we have to re-embrace entrepreneurship. There is no party that can replace the power of an economy based on entrepreneurship. And conversely, there is no economic model that can survive three generations when the majority of the income earners are employees. So we have to start teaching people again, stop going to school, going to college, and getting a good job. Go to school, go to college, and start a business. And if we can shift that, we can shift the mindset. Because people always ask me, Josh, what's caused you to have the political views you have? Was it a seminar? Was it a professor? Was it a pamphlet? And the answer is no, I started a business. When you're a business owner, you figure out pretty quickly you're being taxed too much. You figure out pretty quickly we're involved in too many wars. And all that sort of stuff fixes itself. So if we promote entrepreneurship, if we promote logic, then we're going to be all right.
I agree. And thank you very much, sir, for your time and attention. This is Peter Laver of the UTEP College Republicans signing out. Thank you, everyone, for watching. And Mr. Tolley, have yourself a good day.
No, thank you so much. It's been an honor and a pleasure being with you.
Sir, and God bless. How do I shut this off?
Oh, just end the call?
Sorry. I'm going to end the call. I've never done a YouTube live stream.
That's awesome.
Have a good day, sir.
Yeah, you too. Good job.
Thank Bye. You. Bye-bye.
Okay, and then you go here.